Welcome back to our KO Language Series. Today, we're going to continue working on our speaking skills in a series that we started just last week. In today's episode, we will focus specifically on part one of the KO test, which is called independent speaking. And we're going to answer a practice question, which is called type A. This is just the first question on the KO test. Now, last week, we did talk a little bit about what the raters are looking for when they give you a score for your KO test in speaking. So we're going to start today's episode by reviewing what these elements are so that we can identify strengths and weaknesses in the sample response that we'll listen to today. So the first thing that the raters are going to assess is your delivery skills. This is your public speaking or your presentation skills. So consider all the things that you will need to do with your voice in order to make sure that a listener can effectively hear you. So I guess, first of all, pronouncing the words properly is key. If we're not using proper pronunciation, it's pretty much impossible to assess the rest of this response. We have to hear exactly what it is you're saying. And I think your volume as well as your speed will play into that. So we need to speak at a comfortable volume, loudly enough for people to hear us at least. And the speed should not be too fast, but it also shouldn't be too slow. It should be very comfortable. Again, we want to get the listener from the beginning all the way to the end of our response. So once we've got those basics under control, we then need to start looking at more challenging elements. So I think languages often have a musicality behind them. So there is a definite rhythm as we speak out loud in English. The voice will naturally rise and fall. So this has to do with your intonation. And we try not to, anyways, pause too often or for too long as we're speaking. When we do that, we really interrupt the flow. All right. Another sort of extension of the pause would be called an interjection. So if we are interjecting often, if we say in the middle of just about every sentence, you can imagine how distracting and frustrating that would be for the listener. So again, as we practice, and I do encourage you to practice speaking at home, record your voice into your cell phone, for example, and listen to it back so that you can identify if you are interjecting too much or not. It's natural to interject to a point. I think everybody will do that once in a while, and that's okay. But we can't do it frequently. We can't do it in the middle of every sentence or it becomes problematic. So please keep those skills in mind as you are practicing at home. And again, today, as we analyze this response that we're going to listen to. Now, accuracy of language is the second area that the raters will assess. And this is how suitable and how precise and accurately you're using your vocabulary. So remember, KO is an academic test. So we're hoping that the words you're choosing are higher level, sophisticated, so academic for sure. We should not be using any slang. I would probably not be using idiomatic language, things like that. So keep it academic. Hopefully, you're working on widening your range of vocabulary at home. We don't want to just repeat the same word or phrase over and over again as we speak. So having a very strong vocabulary will help you have a better variety, I guess, as you record your answers. And sentence structure, too, is really important here. So it's academic speaking, so we should be speaking in complete sentences. And hopefully, your sentences are also showing some complexity. So you've got complex sentence structure, compound sentence structure. You might have a few shorter or simpler ideas, but most of your ideas should be a little bit longer, more academic. So you're connecting these short ideas together with the appropriate conjunction. So I think using these linking words and transitions as well in your speaking is going to help the listener understand and follow the answer more smoothly. Now, the content, of course, is important. The details will be assessed for their accuracy as well. I think when we start our speaking response, it's fine if we'd like to offer, say, one sentence of background context, almost like a hook to interest the listener's attention and to also introduce the main topic at hand. But pretty much right in your opening, you should be answering the question. You should be providing your main idea so that the listener understands what the rest of the response will be about. And then you're going to spend the rest of the time developing your answer with specific examples and details as well. So in this first question, you will be speaking about yourself. So hopefully you're drawing on your own life experience as you do so. Your tone should be academic. Again, I mentioned that. So keep that in mind. You're using word choice that demonstrates academics. Avoid the slang and things like that. Hopefully your ideas as well are novel, meaning you have enough main ideas with enough supporting details to fill the talking time comfortably. We don't want to just repeat the same idea to get to the end of the answer. Now, I'm hoping you've saved a little bit of time for your concluding statement. Oftentimes, we'll just summarize the main point we were making right at the end of the answer. You can also leave a next step. Sometimes if there is something that you're going to continue to do next, that might be an appropriate time to offer that idea. Now, last but not least, the raters are going to consider what we call task fulfillment. And this includes two parts. So the first thing, I guess, would be how fully and completely you've answered the question. So are all of your ideas on topic? And the second part of this would be the time that you're talking. So if you're being asked to speak for 1 minute, as we will be doing in today's practice question, then it should be, your answer should be fairly close to that 1 minute. Now, if you finish a little bit early, let's pretend your answer, say, 54 seconds long, but it's very thorough and complete. The raters will be fine with that, okay? They're not looking for perfection. And likewise, if you're cut off in the middle of a concluding statement, let's say, but you've fully supported your answer all the way through, again, the raters will understand that you were finishing and they won't be unhappy with you. They're not looking for perfection. But your goal is to try to get as close as you can to the length of time you're being asked to record. So again, for this type A question, that will be 60 seconds. So what we're looking at right now is exactly what your test will look like, what the screen will look like. So your instructions, I suppose, are always going to be on the left-hand side. And we've just discussed this. So we know that in our answer, we're meant to give details and examples and that we will be evaluated for the content as well as the accuracy of our language. Now, your question itself is always going to be on the right-hand side. So I'll read this one out loud if you'd like to follow, please. It says, do you have a career in mind for after you finish your studies? Have you done any research about what this career requires? Why or why not? So you'll notice again in these first couple of questions on Kale that the questions will be asked about yourself. So I'm hoping that you've got your own life examples that you can draw into your answers that will make it easier for you to think of your ideas. And I mention that because looking up here at your time clock, you'll see that you've got only 30 seconds to prepare for this answer. Okay, so that clock in the middle or the bottom half of the screen will start counting backwards from 30 seconds. And once it reaches zero, it's going to be time to record your answer into your microphone, right into the test itself. All right, so again, the 30 seconds will go quickly. So we have to think of our ideas quite quickly as well. So let's talk very briefly, please, about what you can do with your prep time. So how do we use prep time efficiently? Part of your prep time actually does include reading over the question. So that's important to note. Our question is right now at the bottom of the screen. And you'll notice that there are almost two parts to this question. So the first one asks you to consider a career that you might enter. Okay, so right away during this prep time, if this was your real test right now, I'm hoping that you're thinking of a career of interest and writing down the name of that career on the paper that the test administrators will give you. Okay, use the paper and pen provided to take some quick notes here. The second part of this question as well asks you if you've done any research and you need to explain why or why not. So again, there's sort of two parts to this question. So when you've understood that, you are going to make some basic notes. Now, in 30 seconds, let's say even 25 seconds now, because it will take you some time to read the question through, you will not have time to write full sentences and worry about things like spelling and grammar. Your goal is to write down using short forms and abbreviations to the best of your ability, the main ideas that you plan to talk about, so that when it's time to actually record your answer, you've got a small list of notes in front of you that will keep you on track. Okay, so I'm going to show you right now an example of what a note might look like. Everybody's notes are different, so your style might be very different from this. But we're going to listen to a response, actually, that follows these ideas that were brainstormed during the prep time. So the idea here is to see how closely the answer kind of matches the outline that's been created. So this speaker has identified a career we can see at the top of her page. So it looks like she's interested in entering the field of gerontology, which is working with seniors. It looks like there might be a specific job role that she's going to work into the answer. I see the letters D-I-R period. So I'm assuming that means maybe the director, perhaps the director of a nursing home or something like that. So again, I like how this is starting off. She is identifying a career of interest. Beneath that, she's got some short form ideas that I assume indicate why she's interested in this field. So I can see that she likes to help maybe the aging population, I guess, and also offer support. That could be social support. And again, remember the short forms used in these notes are only important to you. So you're the only one that needs to know what they say. I'm interpreting the notes to the best of my ability here. It looks like this person has indeed done some research. So that was the second part of this question. And I can see three bulleted points there that are listed. So it looks like the speaker will be looking into years of education, I guess, maybe some specialized training. And along with education comes tuition. So it's important, I guess, that she wants to know how much money is going to go into the regular training or upkeep, I guess, for this job. So she's trying to address, I suppose, what the career would require by finding these pieces out. The last part there talks about skills and attributes. So that makes sense as well. So we need to know what we're going to be expected to do and what personality traits even that we have or attributes that might make us suitable for the job or perhaps not suitable. So these are things, I guess, to find out before you enter the field. Now, the closing here talks about interviewing an aunt. We haven't heard the answer yet, but we can assume maybe that the speaker has an aunt that works in this field, and that's why the speaker wants to interview her. So we'll need to listen to the answer, I guess, to make more sense of that. So remember, this is a 60-second question. It might sound like a long time, but look at all the things that we have to talk about in that 60 seconds. So I think it's actually going to go quite quickly. We're going to listen to this answer today twice. The first time we listen to it here, you can follow along with the notes if you wish, but the goal here is to really assess those speech delivery skills. I'm hoping that together we can identify the strengths and the weaknesses of that presentation. So we're listening for her pronunciation and her rhythm and her intonation. Try to assess if she's interjecting or pausing too much. So these are the things that I'd like you to focus on the first time you hear this answer. We'll talk about the other skills after we're finished there. Okay, so here's the first response. Let's listen to it now.
My studies. I'm very interested in pursuing a career in gerontology. Ultimately, I would like to become the director of care at a senior's home because our population is aging and I think it's important to provide social support and a comfortable lifestyle to older adults. I have already done some research into this to determine how many more years of specialized training I'll need beyond completing my high school and a bachelor's degree. Tuition is expensive, so I wanted to know how much to budget for my entire education. I've already started looking into the skills and attributes I'll need to be successful in this role. My aunt is a registered nurse who has been working with seniors in a care home for the past 20 years, so I plan to conduct an informational interview with her to help me decide if this is a job I would enjoy doing long term.
Okay, so that's the answer there. I will let you know that that one clocked in at 56 seconds, and it's supposed to be about a minute. So this would be a very appropriate length for this type of an answer. It's pretty close to what's expected, so it's fine. So we're just right now going to look at the delivery skills. So these first four criteria here in the checklist. So I feel that her pronunciation was fine. I had no trouble understanding the words, even without a transcript in front of me. So that's the very first step. I think her volume was also acceptable, and the speed was not problematic. It wasn't too fast, it wasn't too slow. So I think she's got her basics covered. I didn't notice too many long pauses, so that wasn't a problem. I did notice a couple of interjections. So there were certainly a few of these ums and ahs, but they didn't happen too much so that they weren't problematic, they weren't distracting. I think all of us will interject from time to time naturally, especially as we're thinking on the spot. So it's okay to do that once in a while. So don't worry about that too much from home if you are interjecting once in a while. It would be a problem if we interjected all the way through, okay? But this speaker, I think she does a good job handling these pauses and interjections. They weren't problematic. The one weakness, though, of her speech delivery skills, I would recommend she practice a bit more, would be to adopt a more appropriate or a natural rhythm, and a little bit maybe with the intonation. I noticed as she was speaking, there were some times where she paused to take a breath that happened almost in the middle of a sentence. And when we're speaking, it's really important to wait until the end of the sentence, or at least the end of a clause, you know, the end of an idea where the comma would come, to take a pause for breath. If we are speaking in long sentences, sometimes we do need to pause for breath before we get to the end. But I did notice there were a few unnatural pauses here right in the middle. And I'm wondering too, if part of that comes from the speaker actually looking at her notes and speaking at the same time. So remember this as you practice from home. It does take practice to follow along a list of ideas that you've written out and try to convert those into natural speech on the spot. So I think sometimes the pausing was coming from her trying to figure out how to get that idea next into the answer. Okay, so bear that in mind. Overall, I think her speech delivery skills were strong. We could certainly understand they were clear, but there are a few areas that she could continue to work on there, I think, for that. All right, what I'd like to do is play this sample response one more time, and we're really going to hone in on the language that she uses. We'll try to find examples of precise and academic language too, and some transitions. And we're also going to assess the quality of her ideas to make sure that she supported it well enough and fully answered the question. As we're listening the second time, we will follow along with the transcript of her ideas. Now on the real test, the raters will not have a transcript. They will simply listen to the recording that you've made during the test, and they will give you a score based on that. But as we are studying together, I feel it's very helpful for all of us to actually see the words before us as we listen. And that way it will really focus our attention on these skills that we're trying to learn about. Okay, so again, I'll play the response now. Follow along, please. From home, you're very welcome to try to pick out words that you feel are very precise and interesting. And maybe there are words here that you would revise. So we'll discuss that in a moment after we've listened again.
My studies, I'm very interested in pursuing a career in gerontology. Ultimately, I would like to become the director of care at a senior's home because our population is aging and I think it's important to provide social support and a comfortable lifestyle to older adults. I have already done some research into this to determine how many more years of specialized training I'll need beyond completing my high school and a bachelor's degree. Tuition is expensive, so I wanted to know how much to budget for my entire education. I've already started looking into the skills and attributes I'll need to be successful in this role. My aunt is a registered nurse who has been working with seniors in a care home for the past 20 years, so I plan to conduct an informational interview with her to help me decide if this is a job I would enjoy doing long term.
Okay, so there's that second listening through. What you were looking at right now are all of the conjunctions or transitions that the speaker has used to connect and organize the response. So these are the words in blue. So at a quick glance, I do see some basic conjunctions. So these are words like and so, right? She's used them a few times and that's fine. These are simple words, but grammatically they do connect these ideas together. More importantly, I'm also seeing evidence of some more complex structures. So words like after, because, and if. When we use these words properly, as the speaker has done, we are creating complex sentence structure. So that would balance out some of the simpler ideas as well. So she's on the right track here, at least with her connections, and demonstrating a good variety of sentence structure. Aside from just those individual words, there are also some other transitions. And you'll notice that they have to do with time. So she opens her entire response with, after I complete my studies. And throughout she says things like ultimately and already and beyond. So because she's telling the story of her own, I guess, educational career, if we can call it that, it makes sense to add these words to organize, you know, what's happening now and what will happen next and even after that into the future. So I think by adding in these words here and there as she's done throughout this response really does help to effectively organize it. So again, she's on the right track there with her transitions and her conjunctions. The sentence structure looks like it's varied. So these are all strengths. Let's look at the vocabulary as well now. So some of the individual words or phrases, these are the words in red that you can see. So all of these words are certainly on topic. They all suit the task where she's talking about entering this career in gerontology. So I like how she opened that, pursuing a career in gerontology, she says. Nice opening. All right. And words like specialized training and conduct an informational interview and so on. So again, all of these words that we're looking at make sense for the task. All right. They're suitable. They're used accurately. We are seeing evidence of some more academic language coming out. There are, though, if you can look at the underlined words that have been bolded, there are a few examples here of some common everyday words that I think with a little bit of practice, we could probably convert or elevate to make them more academic. So that first phrase, it's about four lines down, and she says, I have already done some research into this. So the idea makes sense, but it is also a little bit simple. I think just by revising the language ever so slightly, it would elevate the tone. So she might say something like, I've already researched how many more years of specialized training I'll need. So something like that would be a bit more effective, maybe. That next example down where she says, I've started looking into the skills and attributes. When we use phrasal verbs like looking into, it's a little bit simple once again. I would try to avoid using expressions like that as they're not as high level, I guess, as other ideas. So instead of saying looking into the skills, she might have said, I've also started considering the skills and attributes. So again, we're just replacing a few words here and there to try to elevate the overall tone. At the very end where she says about she would enjoy doing the job long term, again, it's just a little common. So maybe adding in an adverb or some more descriptive language would really finish off this answer with more complexity. Maybe she could say, I could passionately commit to doing the job long term, or I could passionately commit to long term would be fine. Something like that. Anyway, you get the point. I think she's got a very nice foundation for her vocabulary. I do see evidence of some very specific words used accurately and precisely. I do, though, see a little bit of some simple language that needs to be elevated a bit. So again, some strengths and a couple of areas there for improvement with the vocabulary itself. Okay, so let's shift gears once again. Let's really get into the content and the organization as well. So we're looking right now at her opening and her closing to see how well she's framed the answer. So the question on the test was sort of a twofold, right? We first had to talk about our field and then talk about if we've done research. So I think simply by introducing the field of choice in the beginning is very effective here, where she says she's going to be pursuing a career in gerontology. That's great. At the very end, after she's discussed some of the research that she's doing, she does bring the answer right back again to talking about this job and asking herself almost if it's suitable and something she would enjoy doing long term. So I think by starting and ending by considering this career, she's actually framed her answer quite well. She does also talk about conducting this informational interview to gather more information. So it is almost like she's suggesting a next step or a future step. So it seems like an effective way to finish off with an answer. Now we'll look at, I guess, the sort of the two parts to this question. So the first part here in green talks a little bit more about why gerontology, I guess, is interesting to her. So I like the fact that she's identified a particular role or job title. So director of care, I guess, is this ultimate goal that she wants to pursue. And you can see that she's got three very logical and specific reasons why she'd want to work in this role. So again, I think that's an effective way to introduce the topic and have the listener understand where she's coming from before she starts talking about the research, which is the second part of the question. So she has done research, she tells us. That was part of the question to determine whether or not you have, why or why not. So yes, she has done some research. And she does mention three specific things that she'd like to learn more about or that she's in the process of learning more about. So they focus around specialized training, her tuition, I guess, as well as the skills and attributes. So she does support some of these ideas a little bit better than others, I think. I know when she speaks about her education, she does mention, of course, about finishing high school and then pursuing a bachelor's degree. It might have been nice to give us a focus, like a bachelor's degree in medicine, maybe. I don't know. It sounds like maybe she's already done some research into specialized training. So it would be nice here, just as an extension, to mention if there is additional program or more specialized programs that she would need to take, sort of looking at the big picture long term. right? So what else will she have to do to upgrade, I guess, as she continues to work in that field? That would have been just a nice little detail to add there. But again, she has mentioned some of the educational needs that are required. So high school and bachelor's degree. So that's great. Good start. Talking about the tuition, I think is a good idea. You know, how much to budget for the entire education. Again, if she's already looked into that, it might have been nice here to give a dollar amount if she's got that information. If not, I guess it's fine. That last point, the skills and attributes, this is a really interesting area of research. I think it's probably one of the more important areas of research of the three that she's mentioned. So it would have been nice to spend a little bit more time, even giving a couple of examples there of some of the skills that would be necessary. Now, I understand, as we look again at what she said here, she is in the process of looking into or understanding what skills that she needs. So at this point in time, she very likely doesn't have that information to share. So she almost gets away with not supporting the skills and attributes with specific examples because she establishes that she's in the process of interviewing her aunt to determine that. Nonetheless, it would have been nice to give a couple of, for instances, you know, maybe to consider what skills she brings to the field, and then maybe where she'll go from there. That's just one little thing I might have wanted to add in. That as it is, she does fill 60 seconds of talk time comfortably, so there might not have been a lot of room for development anyway. Overall, I think her task fulfillment is quite fine. She did speak for the full length of time, more or less, so 56 seconds is acceptable for the length of time. She doesn't get cut off, which is also very nice. And I think she has actually answered the question. She has provided details that fit into both aspects. She has considered her career. She has considered as well the research she'd like to do or has already done. Okay, so again, she has fully answered the question. We've already established there are a few areas that she might have extended a little bit further. But I think overall, she's off to a very good start. She has the understanding of how to speak publicly in order to convey meaning around a topic at hand with some support. So this is a great start for her, for sure. To summarize, I guess, the skills that you will need to demonstrate when you complete your own test. So type A, this is the first question on KO. Remember, you've only got 30 seconds of talk time. So you're going to want to very quickly decide what it is you're going to talk about. You have to be decisive, make a choice, and think about how you'll support that. To fill 60 seconds, I think if you had at least two sort of main ideas, that would be enough, as long as you had enough details for each. So the question, the way it was asked, almost gave us sort of two parts of the question. So by talking about the career here of interest and why it's interesting, and then establishing what we're in the process of researching and why, I think that this question sort of organizes itself when you look at it that way. But we do need to have enough examples there to fill the 60 seconds of talk time. So please keep that in mind. You might need to be flexible on the spot. So if you've already talked about everything in your notes and you still have 15 seconds on the clock, you might have to come up with another main idea right there on the spot. So please be flexible with that as well. When you begin your answer, please establish the topic right away. Our test taker today did that quite effectively when she opened up or introduced the idea of studying gerontology. So that was helpful. And the last thing we'll mention here about these questions where you're talking about your own personal experience, it's okay to personalize these answers. I know in an academic setting, we're often taught not to use personal pronouns. So we try to avoid using words like I and you, right? Because we're trying to create an academic tone. But because this question specifically asks you about your own educational experience, it's perfectly fine and necessary, I would say, to use that pronoun I. So draw on your own experience too as you speak. You're welcome to create details if you want on the real test as long as they answer the question. So bear that in mind as well, please. But it is usually much easier to speak about real life experience because those ideas are at the top of your mind and you'll have maybe a little bit of an easier time formulating those ideas into sentence form with the correct vocabulary, if these are things that have actually happened to you. All right, so that was a quick glance at one practice question, just to give us a sense, I guess, of the types of questions that we might encounter on the KO test, and to also look at approaches as to how to come up with ideas and how to put it all together on the spot. All right, next week, we're going to continue working on our speaking skills. Join me then.